nice to be here again to talk to you, to lead you in this devotional period where we get to talk about things besides English. We're going to use English, but we don't look at the typical topics that most people talk about in their English classes. This specifically is talking about God, and so we're going to look at some things about God. Specifically, we've been looking at Jesus and some of the things that he did, some of the things that he said about himself. Last week he talked about himself being the bread of life and also about being the light of the world. And as the light of the world, God is sending Jesus to be that light, a light that shines in the darkness. That's what it says. And so when we think of light, we think of understanding, truth, knowledge, those kinds of things where I didn't know before, I was in the dark about something, and now I'm in the light, I understand, I see, it makes sense to me now. And so Jesus brought that. As the light of the world, he brought truth and life and light and understanding. He also brought life. But when he talks about himself, he's telling us some very, very important things about himself. Things that are real truth that everyone needs to know in order to know God, in order to know who God is and what God wants from us, and what is this relationship that we have with God? What does he want from us? And so Jesus is here to tell us that. That's why he came. And he wrote. And people wrote down the words that he spoke. And so he tells us things about himself using symbols. Again, we talked about metaphors and figurative language. A symbol that of one thing that doesn't seem to really be to make sense, and yet when we see it as explaining something about him, then we can see another part, another aspect of Jesus, that when we put them all together, then we can see more, understand more of who he is and what is he supposed to do, what is he supposed to mean to us. And so he tells us, he describes himself in a number of different ways. Last week we talked about him being the bread of life. And we talked about him as the light of the world. And so Jesus came in truth and grace. And while he was talking to the people, while he was talking to the Pharisees and to his own followers, his disciples, he told about himself as a shepherd, as someone who takes care of sheep. Again, I told you about how many of the things in the Bible relate to agriculture, to farming, to planting, to raising crops, to fruit, and things like that, because that's what the people's lives were about. And so now he's saying that the people are like sheep, and he is like a shepherd. He is a shepherd. And so he compares himself as a shepherd. He says, I'm the good shepherd, to shepherds, priests, and leaders who were before him. And he said, many of those leaders in the past, the priests, they just used the people. They took advantage of them. They took their money. They took advantage of them in many ways, but they didn't help the people. They didn't do anything for the people. They didn't heal them. They didn't give them, they didn't bless them and give them understanding and assurance of who they are and who God is and where they're going to be for eternity. There was nothing in there that really helped the people. And so Jesus did that. He says, I am one who comes to help the people, the sheep. So he describes people like you and me as sheep. Now, we can talk about all the things that the characteristics of sheep, and how you don't want to think of yourself as a sheep, but compared to God, we are like sheep. We're very helpless. We don't have natural defenses. We don't have natural ways of taking care of ourselves. We need a shepherd. We need someone to take care of us. And so Jesus says, I am that one. I'm the one to take care of the sheep. And so here he talks about sheep being in a sheep pen. And so I'm going to read this to you out of John 10. It said, Jesus said, it is certainly true that when a man enters the sheep pen, now, a sheep pen is like, it's a large area that's closed in by, who knows? I mean, it could have a fence around it. I'm not a very good artist, but anyway. Okay, that pen is close enough. Anyway, he says, when a man enters the sheep pen, this is, we call this a pen here. When he enters the sheep pen, he should use the gate. You see that gate there? That's a gate. He should use the gate. If he climbs in some other way, if he goes over the fence, he is a thief. He is trying to steal the sheep. He just wants to take advantage of the sheep. He just wants them to use them, to sell them, to eat them, whatever. He's trying to steal the sheep. But the man who takes care of the sheep enters through the gate. The shepherd, the real shepherd, goes through the gate where he belongs, where he's supposed to go through, right? He is the shepherd. The man who guards the gate opens the gate for the shepherd, and the sheep listen to the voice of the shepherd. He calls his own sheep using their names, and he leads them out. He brings all of his sheep out. Now let me explain. When in a village or where there's houses around, they have sheep pens with fences and so on, with gates, where the shepherds can take out their sheep in the morning, lead them up to eat in the pastures and so on in the fields, and bring them back at night and put them all together in the large pens. Now, a shepherd may have, I don't know how many sheep he might have, but he may have 25 or 30 here, but there may be other shepherds who also have sheep in the same pen. They're all in the same pen and there's one person who guards it at night to keep the wolves and the coyotes and the bears and lions or whatever else might hurt the sheep. He guards them, and the shepherds go into the village or into the town, into their house, and sleep, and then get up the next morning, come and get their sheep and take them back out to this pasture. And they're all together. And so you understand what the shepherd is doing. He's going to through the gate for his sheep. And it says, the man who guards the gate opens the gate for the shepherd. The guard at the gate, he knows the shepherd. He's not a thief and he's not a robber. So he knows his shepherd. And so he says, come on in, get your sheep, right? So he does. He goes in and gets his sheep. The man who's guarding the gate lets him in. And it says, he opens the gate for the shepherd. And the sheep listen to the voice of the shepherd. He calls his own sheep using their names, and he leads them out. And you say, well, why do the sheep have names? Well, I grew up on a dairy farm. We had dairy cows. We had 100 dairy cows. Every one of the cows had a name. There was a way of identifying the cow. And we knew every one of them. They all were different, right? They all looked different. I could see that this was one name, and you know, and I could call them by name. And because the shepherd, or in our case, because we had feed for them, they would follow us. They would run to come to where we are, where we feed them. And they hear our voice and they know us, right? And so the sheep, they hear the shepherd's voice and they know the shepherd's going to take them out to where there's something good to eat. And so they trust him because he's their shepherd. They know him. They know his voice. They don't even have to see him. They can hear his voice and they know his voice. And so because he spends a lot of time with them. The good shepherd spends all of his days with his own sheep out in the pasture, giving them good water and food and grass to eat. He leads them where they need to go, and they follow him. It says, and the sheep listen to the voice of the shepherd. He calls his own sheep using their names, and he leads them out. He doesn't drive them. He doesn't have a stick. Doesn't have to beat them. They willingly, of their own will, they follow him. They all come out. The other sheep, they stay there because it's not their shepherd. When they hear their shepherd's voice, they'll come out. But they won't if it's a different shepherd because they say, he's not my shepherd. I don't follow him. So they stay in the pen. All the sheep that belong to that shepherd, they all come out, right? He leads them out. He brings all of his sheep out. He doesn't leave any of them in because they all need to eat, right? Then he goes ahead of them. He leads them. And yeah, he goes ahead of them and leads them. The sheep follow him because they know his voice. He says, come on, follow me. So they do. But sheep will never follow someone they don't know. They will run away from him because they don't know his voice. Now, there's a much that we could learn about spending time with God, God's word, listening to his voice, and knowing him, his voice, when you find through prayer and constant spending time with God, he's your shepherd, he's our shepherd, he's my shepherd. By knowing his voice, I know I don't listen to Satan, I don't listen to other bad voices. I only listen to God because he's my shepherd. I know his voice. When I get to know him, I spend a lot of time with him. I get to know him. I don't follow anybody else. I know his voice. And so I follow him. He leads me to where I need to go, to what I need to do, to good things. In fact, it says here, they run away from the other guy because they don't know his voice. Jesus told the people this story, but they didn't understand what it meant. He's telling them about sheep and shepherds, and they're trying to figure out, what do you mean, talking about sheep and a shepherd? So Jesus said again, I assure you, I am the gate for the sheep. All those who came before me were thieves and robbers. All those leaders, all those priests and so on in the past, they were thieves and robbers, right? The sheep didn't listen to them. They didn't follow them because they didn't help them. I am the gate. This is the first I am for today. First he says, I'm the gate for the sheep. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will be able to come in and go out. They will find everything they need. Now, I need to explain something else. Now, when the shepherd brings the sheep back to the pen every day, they all go together and he calls his sheep out and only his sheep come with him and he leads them out. Now, if they're out in the hills and they're far away, they don't get to come back to the village or to the houses and the sheep pen and so on, he will hold them there. He'll find a place where there's natural defense, like big rocks around, a cave, or trees that are very close, and that he can hold his sheep in one spot. And maybe at the mouth of the cave, or at the mouth of this opening where the rocks are, he puts himself. He will actually sleep there in the way, in that gate area, to keep the sheep from coming out, but mostly to protect the sheep from wolves and bears and lions and so on, who would come in and attack the sheep and would take them. So he himself is their guard. He's their gate. He lies there. In order to get to the sheep, the wolves have to go over the shepherd, through the shepherd, and he won't let that happen. He protects the sheep. So when they're out there, he becomes the gate for them. And so Jesus is describing himself as the gate where that saves the sheep, that protects the sheep, that keeps them safe, and where they can come out past him into good things. Let me read it for you again. Jesus says, "I assure you, I am the gate for the sheep. All those who came before me were thieves and robbers. The sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved." Everyone who enters through Jesus will be saved. He's the gate. You pass through him to get to safety, to heaven, to God, to goodness, to peace, to love, to life. Remember? Life? Yeah. They will be saved. They will be able to come in and go out. They will find everything they need. A thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But I came to give life. See that life again? I came to give life. Life that is full and good. Abundant life. Not just life, but overflowing life. Wonderful life. That's why Jesus came, to give good life to his sheep, to the people. That's why Jesus came, to be that kind of gate of safety, of salvation, a gate of salvation for the people. Now he's going to describe himself in a different way. He says in verse 11, "I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd gives his life for the sheep." Now here's a different thing. He's a good shepherd who defends his sheep, even giving his life for his sheep. That's how important the sheep are to the shepherd. Different from all the ones who were before him, he cares for the sheep. That's what it's going to say here. It says, "I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. The worker who is paid to keep the sheep is different from the shepherd. The paid worker does not own the sheep, so when he sees a wolf coming, he runs away and leaves the sheep alone. Then the wolf attacks the sheep and scatters them. The man runs away because he is only a paid worker." He's just a hired worker. He's not a shepherd who owns the sheep, who cares about the sheep, who loves the sheep, who takes care of the sheep because he cares for them. He's just a hired worker. They said, "Oh, go take care of the sheep." He said, "Sure, I can do that." But when something happens, he said, "No, I'm out of here. I'm not giving my life for those sheep. Let the wolf have them." You see, that's the difference between Jesus and everyone else who came before him. He says, "The man runs away because he is only a paid worker. He does not really care for the sheep. I am the shepherd who cares for the sheep. I know my sheep just as the Father," talking about the Father in heaven, God the Father, "I know my sheep just as the Father knows me, and my sheep know me just as I know the Father. I give my life for these sheep." He knows his sheep personally, by name. They know him personally, by voice, by sight, by smell, by everything. There's such a close and personal relationship that he would lay down his life for his sheep. He would give his life for his sheep. We heard that 2 weeks ago, where Jesus gave his life so that you and I might be saved. Here he says, long before he's actually arrested and crucified, he gives this story about himself. He says, "I'm giving my life for my sheep. I'm giving my life for the people." That's what he's saying. Jesus, who is the good shepherd, says, "I give my life for my sheep, because I care for them. And I know them just like I know the Father in heaven And just like the Father in heaven knows me, I know my sheep and they know me. And I give my life for the sheep. So, that's who Jesus is. That's two more things that we can know about Jesus because of what he says about himself. He is the gate of salvation. We must enter through him to be saved, to be protected, to have peace and hope and life. And he gives us an abundant life. We can go out and have all that we need. He is the gate for that too. And he's the good shepherd. He takes care of his sheep. His sheep know him. He knows his sheep. He cares for them. And he lays down his life for them. He gives his life for the sheep so that they might be saved. So that they might be saved and have life. That's who Jesus is. Next week we'll learn some more about who Jesus is. But he describes himself as a good shepherd, as a gate for the sheep, for you and me. You're a sheep, and I'm a sheep. And praise God for that. Praise God for Jesus. That's my lesson for today. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for your words. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for all that he is and all that he has done and all that he will do for us. Thank you for his life. Thank you for his willingness, because of his love for us, to give his life for us. Thank you for that shepherd. Lord, help us to know his voice. Help us to know him. Help us to know the Father. Help us to know the love that was so great that he would be willing to die for us. Lord, I pray for a blessing upon our students today, upon our teachers, upon this institution. I pray that you bless us all today. In Jesus' name, amen.